Wow. Hey folks, great. I've been told to behave myself today. There's some women here today. There's some beautiful women, isn't there? Wow, a couple of fucking howlers as well, but never mind. You know who you are. I thought Gregor might have been here, because I need to tell you a true story about Gregor. Is he coming in? Gregor, as well as being the coach, Gregor's actually in the Guinness Book of Records for holding his breath underwater. There, Gregor, there we go. Am I right, Gregor? Edinburgh Commonwealth Pool, remember that day? Gregor held his breath underwater for 8 minutes and 42 seconds. Remember that day, Gregor? When the wee girl came in with her dad and says, "That's the man there, Dad." Fucking hell. I love my job. Now I love this job that I do. I've got a rugby clubs, you know. I have met some fun. I've met legends like this, you know. I've met some arseholes as well. The Hastings brothers is my favourite one. I'm going to tell you a true story about the Hastings. I was doing a golf celebrity thing with Scott Hastings, a true story. And we're on the fairway and Scott Hastings' phone went. And he gets his phone and goes, "Ah, fuck." I says, "What's wrong?" He goes, "My granny's just died." I said, "Look, it's just charity. Just go home." He says, "No, no, I'm fine, I'm fine." So Scott plays his next shot and the phone goes again. He goes, "My day can't get any worse." He goes, "What's happened?" He goes, "That's Gavin's granny's died as well." You talk about meeting Princess Anne and Gregor as well. Best story I ever heard about a rugby player meeting Princess Anne was Peter Wright. Peter Wright was sitting next to Princess Anne at the dinner after the game. Princess Anne is wearing the silk chiffon blouse that she always wears at internationals, you know. And it was cherry roulade, it was for the suite. And she's eating the cherry, and a bit of little cherry stain rolled down her blouse, a big stain down her blouse. And she got her hanky, and she goes, "Oh, Peter, I do hope cherry stains come out." He goes, "So they are, I've just fucking ate two." Now, by the way, I'm lucky to be here. I need to tell you a true story. I'm lucky to be here because some of you will know I've been ill. It's a true story. Liver cancer, 4 tumours, and they gave me 6 months to live. There we go. And this November there, I got my new liver, so I'm here, back again. So, the worst thing ever about getting a liver transplant was I was stuck in the house with a wife. But I had to talk to the wife 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for 6 weeks. I had to talk to the wife only. I have never talked to my wife as much as that in my life. I didn't think she didn't work in Woolworths anymore, honestly. Of course, I'm getting better now, you know. I'm trying to spruce up the sex life. So I took it to see that Shades of Grey last night. There I was this morning, B&Q, duct tape, tie wraps. She says, "Big man, tie me to the bed and you can do what you want." So here I am. Ah, can I? But Preston Pans is a weird and wonderful place. I remember this girl, that's a true story. 17 year old when I played at Preston Pans, you know. And this girl took me back to her house and she showed me the kitchen and the settee. And then she took me in the house. Upstairs to her bedroom through the turnstile. Signed the visitor's book, you know, it was great. Aye. And that was the days, remember the days when you had everybody had the white melamine shelving? Remember in the bedroom all the white melamine, pink wallpaper, pink carpet, and the white melamine shelving. Top shelf was a big, huge teddy bear. The next one was middle-sized teddy bears. And the bottom two shelves was trinkets, you know, jewellery boxes, ornaments. And when you're young, you can go all night, you know, so there I was making love all night. Next again morning, I asked the question you're not meant to ask, but I says, "Was I all right?" She goes, "You were no bad. You can take anything you want off the bottom two shelf." Preston Pans. And by the way, it's Preston Pans, 17-year-old. It's a true story. I need to get my juice. Preston Pans, I had my very first mother and daughter sex. Wow. Cheers, boy. 17-year-old. She was 52. I was 17-year-old. Right? And she said, "Do you want to come back to the house, big man?" I says, "Thank you very much." Went back to the house, and this woman, 52, says to me, "Have you ever had mother and daughter sex?" I went, "No." She goes, "Would you like some?" I went, "Oh, I." And she went to the bottom of the stairs. She went, "Mum, are you still up yet?" Things were weird in Preston. I remember there's the two girls left to Preston Lodge Rugby Club to walk home, cold night. And they're going past the fields, and we Effie says to her pal Singer, she goes, "Oh, Singer," she goes, "I'm awfully tired, I'll need to lie down." She says, "You can't lie down, it's freezing. I'm just going to, you walk back and get me a taxi, come and collect me." So Singer goes away, gets a taxi, comes back, stops through the field, and she's no there. And they look in the field, and there's Effie lying underneath a cow, sucking one of its teats. She goes, "In the name of Christ, Effie, what are you doing?" She goes, "Surely one of these four boys has got a motor." And I was like, I'm just getting a level, but we're all right. And this is me behaving myself, by the way. Things have changed. I'm getting old, new things have changed. And breastfeeding, right? Now the young girls just flapping them out and breastfeeding. No maddy, right? And I got on the bus to go from Trinity, where I stay now, down to Preston Pans, the port seat, same bus. You see my mum. A young girl gets on with a baby and gets a barista out in the bus to feed the baby, right? And she's going, "Come on now." And I'm sitting right behind her, you know. "Come on now. Take the titty, or I'm going to give it to the man." I went, "Yeah, dad." Buses were never like a maddy, I mean, man. "Come on now, take the titty, or I'm going to get..." Well, I'm getting ready. I thought, "Here we go, you're dancing." "Come on now." I said, "Whoa, whoa, 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 look, hen. Make your mind up. I've missed the stop three times already." Another thing about playing the rugby is you get the older boys. When you're a young boy playing rugby, it's great to get advice for the older boys, you know. And one of the best advice I ever got, I played at Preston Lodge. Remember the prop, Pudge? Pudge was the prop above me, right? And I remember I went back to training one night. I said, "Pudge," says me, "what's wrong, big man?" I says, "Pudge, unbelievable." I went home pissed the other night there, right? Got to the front door and I pressed the button. The door opened, she slammed the door. I had to sleep in the garden. I was frozen. Pudge says to me, "Do what I do, son. When I go home drunk, before I press that button, I take all my clothes off, press the button. And when she opens the door, you throw all your clothes in. Right? Now she's not going to make a fuss because the neighbours are watching, so she'll pull you inside, then kick fuck at you, but at least you're warm." Oh, hee-haw, great idea. Next thing you make about training, Podge, "How'd you get on?" I says, "Podge, nightmare." He goes, "What happened?" "Well," I says, "went him drunk, and before I pressed that button, I remember what you said. So I stripped naked, and I pressed the button, and I threw all my clothes in the door. All of a sudden, the door closed. Poof, and the voice went, "Next stop, Edinburgh Waverley." But then I got my humour as I worked in the pit. Right? Manual labour and like the farmers here, manual labour. And that's where I learnt my humour, because miner's humour, if you didn't care, miner's humour is you'll never be beaten. You'll even rip the piss at yourself to win the guy, right? And I'm going to tell you, honest to God, hand on heart, true story, right? Working in the pit, it's a true story. Engineer doing Moncton Hall Colliery, and one of the engineers had a very bad accident, and he lost his arm from the elbow down. And after a few months, he was coming back to the pit to visit the apprentices, right? So we all got together, and we bought the man a watch. This is true. And not to be beaten, he used to wear a watch on his stump, right? And I used to make an arse, right? "What time is it?" We're like, "Oh, for fuck's sake, it's 10 past. So one day, I felt a bit sorry. It's a true story. I felt a bit sorry for Wally. I said, "Wally, I'm not being funny, right? Would it not be better if you wore the watch on your other arm?" And he says to me, "And how the fuck will I wind it up?" And you go, Remember when you're an apprentice? Remember you used to wind up your apprentice? Remember that one? Away for a long stand. Remember that one? Or away and get sparks for the grinder. That was a great, you know. I'm going to, ladies and gentlemen, I am going to tell you the best apprentice wind up story ever. Hand on heart, true story, honest to God, true story, right? My mate works for the police morgue in Edinburgh. And he started a wee boy from Nidri. You heard the Nidri? That's where the window cleaner's got a sander. And he says to this wee boy, true story, honestly, says to the wee boy from Nidri, "You want to give us a hand?" He goes, "What is it? What is it?" He goes, "A big police sergeant comes here, thinks we're thick, treats us like shit, right? He's coming to look at a body. Now, he's not seen the body, so what we're going to do, we're going to lie you on a slab, we'll put the blanket over your head, and we're going to put you in the fridge. I mean, when the sergeant comes, we're going to pull you out," and you go, "Ah!" The wee boy goes, "Oh, I fuck the boss. Aye. So half an hour later, the intercom going, "Here's the boss. Right, you man, down the stairs." So the wee boy runs down the stairs, lying in the slab. He goes, "I'm dead, fuck the boss, dead. They were just going to put a blanket over. I can't wait. Put a blanket. Wah, put a blanket. And they put the blanket over the wee man's head. Right? They were just going to put it in the fridge. I put him in the fridge. Wah, can't wait. Aye. They were just going to shut the door. Come on. And they put the wee boy in the fridge. And they shut the fridge door. And the wee boy is lying inside the fridge for 2 minutes. Then he got a nudge. It's fucking cold in here, eh? You like that one? I've got an applause. Well done. Brilliant. And the humour's still there. The humour's still the minor. Same here, the farm is a totally different humour, you know. But the minor humour is starts in Trinity, you know. And there's a wee boy from Trinity went down to London. And there's a little blonde girl sitting inside her flat looking awfully depressed. He goes, what's wrong with you? She goes, oh, I've got my gas bill, my phone bill, electricity. I say, look, I'll make you a proposition. She goes, what's that? Let me come in here tonight, make you love to you all night, and I'll give you £50. She goes, I'm not a whore. I didn't say you were, but I'll get my Nat King Cole, bacon roll, and you'll get £50. Go on then. Boys are the first thing. Bumps a bird all night, bacon roll, £50, that's the gas bill covered. He says, can I come back? You're good. Aye, 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 aye. Come back a second night. Boy goes back a second night, me love to the bird, £50, bacon roll, gas bill, phone bill covered. He says, can I come back? You're good. Aye, aye, come back. Aye. Boy goes back a third night, bumps a bird, bacon roll, £50, gas bill, phone bill, electricity bill. He says, look, hen, it's my last night in London. Can I come back? You're good. You can come back. Aye, aye. Boy goes back a last night, bumps a bird, bacon roll, £50, gas bill, phone bill, electricity bill. £50 and her hipper sheet is minted. He says, thank you very much, darling, but I have to go back home now. She goes, where do you come from? He says, I come from a little village called Trinent. Oh, isn't that amazing? I come from Trinent. In fact, my mum still stays in Trinent. He goes, I know, and she gave me £200 to you. I'm getting old, you discover things, you're getting old. Like multitasking, right? I can, now he's 56, I can multitask. I've noticed that I can brush my teeth and pee at the same time. I didn't mean to, just... They're all sitting going, aye, aye, you're right. And I'm married, you know, I the worst thing to getting married is obviously the mother-in-law. I remember when I just got married, my mother-in-law always wanted to visit the sacred Holy Land. True story. So I took the mother-in-law and the wife to the sacred Holy Land. When we're in the Holy Land, the mother-in-law died of a heart attack. Boof. Down she went, clean as a whistle. Like a pleasure trip. Boof. Down she went. And the local undertaker says to me, he says, you can bury your mother-in-law here in the Holy Land for £5, or you can fly your body back to Trinity for £5,000. Ooh. I says, there's the £5,000. Well, the wife burst into tears. She says, that's bad. You could have buried my mum here in the Holy Land for £5, but you're flying her body back to Scotland. I says, listen, hen. 2,000 years ago, they buried somebody here. 3 days later, the bugger got back up again. I got advice, you know, because I've been, my sex life's not been right, I hate talking in front of it, but I've been ill, you know. Try to spruce up your sex life. I bought the wife these new luminous condoms. Wow, should have seen her wee face light up. Now, I got... I thought I'd take the wife out, you know, and the boy says, take your wife out, take your... That's how you keep yourself together. Take your wife out, take your girlfriend out, keep them happy, right? It's true. They're never happy, though, are they? Never happy, no, that's true. I took my wife out for tea and biscuits. She had to give blood, but she got tea and biscuits. And then when you take, sorry girls, but then when you take yous out, you're still no happy. I took her to Dobie's Garden Centre. A typical woman, by the way. I took her to Dobie's Garden Centre for a cup of tea and a scone, right? Time I got to the desk, there's 2 scones left. Big scone and a wee scone. Being the man, what do you do? I put the big scone on my plate and I put the wee scone on her plate. She went, fucking mental. I says, what's wrong with you now? You, a typical man. I says, what have I done now? She says, you've took the big scone. I says, and what would you have done? I would have took the wee scone. I says, you've fucking got the wee scone. And you moan about this, sorry girls, but you moan about the slightest thing. My wife's best ever moan, right? Nap, 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 nap. I says, what's wrong with you now? You, a typical man. I says, what have I done now? She says, you never held the car door open for me. I says, I'm sorry, darling. I just panicked and swamped with the surface. You know what I mean? A lot of things happen, you know. It's, and I'm sorry about the girls. Girls, if I've settled anybody, because I don't like to do that. But I'm going to tell you what girls are good at. Answering the embarrassing sex question that the kids ask. And that is a fact, right? Me and my wife were having breakfast the other morning. An 8-year-old daughter came in. She goes, Mum, Dad. Last night I looked in your bedroom. Dad, you were naked on your back going, Mum, you were naked jumping the top of Dad's belly going, What were you doing? Well, quick as a flash, the wife says, well, hey, you can your dad's putting a bit of beef on, right? I was jumping on your dad's belly to get the air out of him. I went, wow, what an answer. Well done. Then my daughter says, oh, Mum, you're wasting your time. Because when you go to your work, Auntie Jeannie comes round and blows him back up again. It's hard to believe I get shocked, right? Years of working on a pit, years of playing rugby. But I got shocked the other day. I've got a granddaughter in Slothian. Primary 4, he's Slothian. And they're getting sex education in primary 4. That's just no right. That isn't, you know. See, when I was in primary 4, what sex education did I get? Stay away from the Johnny. Now, oh, I need to tell a true story about the wife. This is what I'm married to, right? My wife is just amazing. I get my material from my wife, right? And I'm going to tell you the best story ever about going to see the Drifters in Edinburgh, right? It's a true story. My wife had never seen the Drifter. Winching at the time. What a great word, winching, eh? I mean, that was my real bird. No, my first bird's like Preston Pan, you know, Preston Pan. My very first bird came for Preston, because I played at Preston Pan's. Very first night, kissing, cuddling, hand right down her knickers on the very first night. I says, oh, hen, whew, you have got a fanny like a moose's ear. She says, are you Scottish? I says, no, Canadian. I just saw a slide. The wife, winching at the time, right? And we used to go and see the Drifters. Remember the real Drifters? Johnny Moore. Remember that? Clyde McFarr. No, nowadays I've got a wee Chinese boy and somebody with Kelty and Fife playing the drum, right? But I mean, this is the real Drifter, right? We used to get the bus up for the shipping port, saying, and we used to go, like, 3 times a year, the Drifters can get the real Drifter, right? And my wife, winching at the time, girlfriend says to me, you'll never believe it. I says, what's that? Because my wife talks like that. My wife talks through her nose, right? All day, every day, talks through her fucking nose, right? Why did she talk through her nose? Because her mouth's burnt out, that's why, right? She says, you never take me to see the Drifters. I says, do you like the Drifters? What do they sing? So I made her a tape. There we go, a Walkman tape, right? Oh, the song. Saturday night at the movie. Oh, I like that song, I like that song. Oh, you're more than a number. Oh, she likes that song. Brilliant. So I made her the tape, and she says to me, she's never seen them though. I like the Drifters. Never seen them. I says, I'll get you special tickets for your birthday. We are in Edinburgh Playhouse. Row A. I could touch the stage, right? She's never seen the Drifters, but she knows the songs. Doom, doo, 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 doom, doo, doo, doo. Music comes on. Doom, lights start flashing. Doom, doo, 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 doom. Ladies and gentlemen. Doom, doo, 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 doom. For you tonight. Doom, doo, 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 doo. In Edinburgh Playhouse. Doom, doo, 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 doom. We have the Drifters. And they come on with their white suits on. Doom, doo, 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 doom, can the dip. Doom, doo, 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 right? It's a true story. On the stage, I could touch Johnny Moore, right? And they go, just as they dipped, she stands up and shouts, oh, they're black! I'm sure that wee Johnny Moore goes, what did she fucking say? That's brilliant. Ladies and gentlemen, Enjoy your life. Seriously, I've knocked a big door twice in the last year, right? Knocked a big door twice. Enjoy it. Right, remember, spruce your life up, enjoy your life. You can, there's people on the Titanic that refuse the sweet trolley. I can just go over it, right? And some of you have got closer to the door than me, but never mind. So, gentlemen, I says, ladies as well, get yourself checked. I'm going to finish this story. I had to go and get my prostate. Some of you boys have probably had it, you know. Prostate examination, right? That's another thing, right? That's another thing. Your memory goes at my age, you know? It's a true story. The other day there, right, the other day, out the living room, up the stairs, into the bathroom. You ever done it, you go, what the fuck did that get? Honestly, I couldn't remember what I went to the bathroom for. Then I remember my old mother says to me, if you ever got a room and you forget what you wanted, go back to where you started, and it'll come back. Out the bathroom, down the stairs, in the living room, and there's a wife having an angina attack. I went, tablets, I was gone for get yourself checked out, right, seriously. Go for your prostate, the men here I'm talking to, go up and get the letter, go for your prostate. And I went from, it's a true story, I went from my prostate. Beautiful young nurse came in, Mr. Glenn, and you come, trousers pants down, and I did, and she left the room. Then the boy comes in, you know, with the shiny shoes, coat, glove, and he stuck, never spoke a word, never spoke, just finger, ah, get it. 10 minutes, it's called anal digital manipulation, 10 minutes, ah, never spoke a word, got up, took the glove off, put it in the bucket, and left the room. Just then, a young nurse came back in with a clipboard, and gentlemen, that nurse says to me, what you never want to hear after a prostate, she says, who the fuck was that? Ladies and gentlemen, thanks for listening to me. You've been fantastic. I'll speak to you all later on. Cheers.
Fabulous, Scott. Fabulous. Thank you. Scott Glenn, wonderful.